Hey guys, welcome to the Harvest Lab. We're really excited because today we are going to talk about something.
Hey Sierra, look at what I got from our bee expert.
Oh my gosh. Oh! Did you know that the U.S. Department of Agriculture says that honeybees are responsible for one of every three bites of food we consume? They are hard workers.
Oh my gosh, I've got one better for you. Albert Einstein said if there were no more bees tomorrow, the humankind would only have 4 more years.
Bee, aggressive, bee, bee, aggressive.
Beautiful enthusiasm, Sierra.
Thank you.
I'm Amanda Gray.
I'm Sierra Schoenhofen.
Welcome to the Harvest Lab.
Everyone reacts the same when they see a bee. Those golden creatures that are nothing but a sting away from a hospital visit.
But these little creatures have high value. Not only do they have a significant impact to our plant life, they have a positive impact on our lives and wildlife as well.
And today we'll be talking about the importance of bees and pollination, how we as a community can help save these little bees, and why safe bee removals are so important.
Let's buzz out of here.
We just buzzed into Sierra Vista Nursery in Orange, California to talk to nursery manager Oscar Alba.
In fact, before we do that, Sierra, I don't know if you are aware that bees' greatest contribution is the pollination that they do of 3/4 of the plants that produce food for 90% of the world. That means every third spoonful of food comes from pollination.
Wow, that's amazing. Let's learn more about pollination and talk to Oscar.
Hey, Sierra.
Hey, how are you doing?
Hey, welcome. Hello to our viewers today.
So we want to know a little bit about pollination and what that means to plants and food throughout the world.
That's a great question, Sierra. You know, the bee population has been on decrease lately due to pesticides and many other factors. So when you are buying and planting plants at your house, you're helping the bee population to thrive better.
So we're actually helping the bees, you know, and kind of helping them pollinate more of the flowers and do their jobs.
That is correct.
So right here we have like, what is this?
This is a tomato plant. We need bees to pollinate. If we don't have enough bees to pollinate all the tomato plants, there will be no tomatoes.
Yeah.
Without tomatoes, there wouldn't be any pizza. And without pizza, it would be a sad world.
That's true.
That's very true. So what the bees do, they come and pollinate the male part to the female part on the plant, and that's how we get to get more tomatoes that is gonna be benefiting the farmers and entirely the entire world.
That's awesome. So they create these seeds and that feeds us, but do they feed anyone else?
Yes, indirectly, bees are responsible for producing alfalfa seeds, which you know feed animals, and we can get dairy, meat, and like for cotton, they pollinate the cotton plants. That way we can just get the clothes that we're dressing today.
Awesome. So they clothe us. Yeah, they clothe us too.
It is incredible all the benefits that you get when we have bees in our ecosystem.
Yes. So what does that mean to all of your plants here at Sierra Vista Nursery?
It means a lot. Sierra, you know, the benefit that we're getting from the bees from pollinating plant from plant to plant to plant, it helps to get these beautiful flowers that we have. And at the same time, the more flowers that we are bringing to the communities, to our customers, to the ecosystem, the more we're helping the honeybee population to thrive and be better.
Thank you, Oscar, for joining us today.
Thanks for coming, guys. It was a pleasure to have you at the nursery.
Oh, you look awesome. We're bee suited up and ready to interview beekeeper Hillary Kearney in San Diego, California, to learn more about these bees. Hillary Kearney is the author of 2 books, Queen Spotting as well as Little Book of Bees. She's also creator of Girl Next Door Honey, a beekeeping business that offers educational opportunities to hundreds of new beekeepers each year. She maintains the blog Beekeeping Like a Girl, and her writing on bees has appeared in Modern Farmer and Grit magazines. Her work has been the subject of features in Huffington Post, Vogue, Mother Earth News, and other outlets. She rescues wild bee colonies and manages 60 hives in her hometown of San Diego, California.
So how are you?
Good.
Are you bee-tastic?
Be well.
We're here to learn all about more bees and why they're so important to our gardens and our communities.
There's 20,000 different kinds of bees on Earth, and Southern California actually has one of the richest ecosystems for bees. So we have this huge diversity of bees. A lot of people don't realize that not all bees make honey, Most of them actually live underground or in little twigs and stuff like that. And so honeybees are really special because they're like the only bees that make honey, and they live in that, you know, the colony and the beehive. Most bees just live by themselves.
Wow, that's great.
That's awesome.
Yeah.
Okay. So what's the role of the queen bee in the hive?
So a lot of people think that the queen bee is like a ruler, that she's in charge of the whole hive, but that's actually not true. She just has one job, and it is to lay eggs. So she's the only bee in the colony who can actually mate. All the other female bees, the worker bees, they're all sterile.
Awesome. So we want to learn a little bit more about bees. What is the anatomy of the bee?
Bees have six legs because they're an insect. And a lot of people might think that they have two wings, but they actually have four. There's like a secret pair of wings that's hidden underneath, and they clip together. And that's so when they fly, they can kind of do this, like almost like a helicopter. They have actually five eyes. So again, you might think they only have two when you look at them, but they've got three little secret eyes on top of their head. And that lets them see in the UV light spectrum, which is pretty cool. So they can actually see all these patterns on flowers that are like invisible to us. Which helps them pollinate, it helps direct them. And another cool thing about them is the big eyes that you can see, those are their compound eyes. They see in like a mosaic kind of pattern, so they see lots of tiny little pictures of that makes up a bigger picture. And when you're moving or when the bee is moving, they can see better. So you know how for us, our vision is blurred when we're going fast? The bees, it's the opposite. Their vision's kind of blurry until they're moving, and then it's really clear.
So you talked about a little bit about the hierarchy of bees. Can we hear a little bit more about that?
So most of the beehive is made up of female worker bees. So one hive will have anywhere from like 15,000 to like 100,000 bees. And almost all those are gonna be female worker bees. And so when you're in your gardens and you're seeing bees on the flowers, those are all the female worker bees. The male bees are called drones, and they don't do any work.
They don't make any honey.
Well, it's a natural
hive. They don't make any honey. They don't clean the hive. There's all these little roles that the worker bees do. You know, they clean, they build the comb, they make the honey, they go out and they collect the stuff to make the honey. The male bees don't do any of that. They just hang out, and then once a day they leave the hive and they try to mate with a queen bee from a different colony. And then the queen bee only mates one time in her life. So when she is a new queen, she goes out and she goes on her mating flight, and she'll mate with like 40 or 50 males. And then she comes back and she starts laying all the eggs.
How long is their reproductive cycle?
So to go from egg to bee for worker bees, it's 21 days. And so their lifespan is like 42 days. So worker bees are like working really hard and dying and being born again. So the colony is always turning over. It's always kind of regenerating. But the queen bee can live like 2 to 7 years. So she lives a lot longer.
Wow, and she only mates once?
Yes.
Wow.
She has like a sperm bank inside of her that she stores everything in there.
Wow,
I do have a question. So I know that there's a lot of fear about bees in general. And what do you tell people who are really scared of bees?
Well, I always kind of compare them to our pets. So I always ask people like, do you have dogs and cats at home? And they say yes. And then I say, do they have claws and teeth? Yes. So just because they have claws and teeth, does that mean they're gonna always bite and scratch you? No. When do they do it? When they're scared, or like when they feel threatened, or when there's something weird going on, you know? Yeah. And it's the exact same thing with bees. They don't just fly around trying to sting people. They're not gonna sting just because they have a stinger. They use it when they're scared or threatened, or they're trying to protect their babies, you know, just like anyone, just like any person or animal. But they do this very specific flight when they're upset. They kind of go like this, and they zigzag, and they warn you, like, back up.
Oh, it's like a...
Like, hey, watch out.
Jabbing.
Any other tips to kind of be mindful of if you're coming in contact with bees?
Well, one funny thing is you're not supposed to eat bananas before you go and mess with bees, because they communicate through scent, and they have this scent called the alarm pheromone. So when they feel threatened, they release the smell, and it smells very much like bananas.
Uh-oh.
And if you have eaten bananas and you have that smell on you, then you're like already marked as like an enemy.
Oh, no.
They also don't like the color black, because most of their predators are dark in color. So if you think about bears and skunks and stuff like that, those, they're dark, furry. So don't put on like a black furry coat if you're gonna go be around bees. That'd be a no-go. But yeah, that's kind of why bee suits are usually light in color, white.
And definitely don't swat.
And don't swat, yes. And so most bees aren't gonna try and sting you unless you're near their beehive or unless you directly attack them. And so what people don't realize is a bee is buzzing, and unless you're right near a beehive, she's just checking you out. She's not trying to sting you. She's not trying to tell you anything. She might just think you smell nice.
So the honeybee population, I know, is on a decline. Is there any way that we could help as average people to help the honeybee community?
Yeah, so what's interesting is that honeybees are really unique because they have beekeepers that are taking care of them. And so when the honeybee population is suffering, the beekeepers are gonna make more honeybees. So the honeybees are not really in decline, but a lot of people think they are, but it's a very slight difference. It's that a lot of them are dying. So beekeepers are working really hard to keep their hives alive, and they lose 40% of their hives every year. But what's really concerning about that is that bumblebees and carpenter bees and mason bees and leafcutter bees, all this huge variety of bees, that they're all dying as well, and they're not being protected by beekeepers. And so that to me is the most worrying thing. But the good news is, you know, what you do to help honeybees also helps other bees. So planting lots of pollinator-friendly plants, not using pesticides. The native bees, a lot of them live underground. So I always tell people when you're gardening, don't like till your soil, just layer mulch and layer compost on top, because that will have the same effect, and then you're not disturbing the bee nests underneath. And when I talk about like bee nests being underground, you wouldn't even know they were there, because they're just one bee, you know? It's like a beetle hole, you would have no idea. They don't sting. They're very different from honeybees in that way, but they're super important pollinators, and we need that diversity of pollinators.
That was awesome. Hillary is great.
I know, the bees were so cool. If you want to learn more about Hillary or her beekeeping, check her out on social media on Girl Next Door Honey or on her website. Let's go to the lab.
This is not right.
Nice.
Much better.
Very official.
Hey there, everyone. So declines in pollinator populations could have a serious economic repercussion throughout the United States and the world, including rising food costs, potential crop failures, and much more. According to the University of California, the U.S. alone has seen a 50% decrease in honeybee colonies since 1945, which highlights the danger of over-reliance on a single species. Even the federal government has published the Pollinator Partnership Action Plan, which supports struggling pollinator populations. This federal effort aims to decrease honeybee colony losses to below 15% annually, helping to restore 7 million acres of pollinator habitat.
Wow. If you want to help make a change, here's a couple tips. Plant a bee garden. Go chemical-free for bees. Become a citizen scientist. Provide trees for bees. Create a bee bath. Build homes for native bees. Give beehives and native bee homes. Teach tomorrow's bee stewards. For more information on how you can help save bees, be sure to reach out to your county's bee association or check for the links below.
Can you believe how vital bees are to everyday lives?
Absolutely. Mind-buzzing.
We hope you had fun being here with us today, where science
plus fun equals
the Harvest Lab.